Hi everyone, welcome. Thanks for joining us for the session. I am Mine Tanrınan Demir, Principal Program Manager in Azure Storage. And what we are going to be talking about today is how best to use Azure Storage Services as part of your enterprise workloads. And today I'm going to briefly cover which storage services we have and how they help enterprise workloads. And we're going to focus more on server and database solutions. And we're going to have a database demo using a Cassandra DB retail example. And we will talk about SAP VDI and VMware workloads and how best you can leverage Azure Storage in those scenarios. So we're going to talk about which storage services most apply to your enterprise workloads. We have block storage solutions, we have file services, and object storage. In terms of object storage, it's going to be more covered in HPC session and some cloud native sessions. We're going to be focusing this session on more on block storage and file storage. Block storage offer we have is Azure Disk Storage, and it offers various SKUs and sizes that adhere to your performance needs. And uniquely, it offers Azure Shared Disk Storage for clustering. And because some clustering applications cannot take advantage of file shares, they need block storage specifically. And also, disk pools for VMware is recently announced, which allows scaling your VMware solutions. In terms of file storage, we have a native Azure NetApp Files offering. And we have an Azure File Sync offer, which is unique in terms of providing hybrid storage capability if you are using Windows Server, file server on-premises and wanting to bring it to the cloud. So in terms of enterprise workloads, what are we talking about? Firstly, server and databases. Those are the most common workloads customers want to adopt cloud for when they think of cloud initially. And in case of server and databases, both block and file storage applies in different scenarios. SAP, similarly, we have SAP apps and databases, both disk storage as well as file storage offers apply. And VDI for OS disk, the Azure Disk Storage is a consideration. In case of user profile storage, Azure Files and Azure NetApp Files are a consideration and play a critical role in the performance. And similarly, VMware, both NetApp Files and Disk Pools are in preview. And hybrid storage, as we talked about, we have a unique offer for Windows Server file storage. And custom apps, similarly, they can take advantage of all of these offers. Let's start with your server workloads needs. Many of these workloads, as you think about bringing them to the cloud, will have VM and disk configuration considerations. What we see most customers trying to do is that they are used to seeing certain type of performance on premises and they want to observe the same in the cloud. So to do this, we offer different SKUs and sizes to best adhere to your needs. So you can choose the performance you need without having to pay for higher performance that you may not have use for. So from that perspective, most mission critical workloads actually work with premium SSDs really well. In cases of, let's say, light demand web server kind of workloads, standard SSDs might work well as well. And we see standard HDDs mostly used for standard test workloads or backup type of workloads. On the other hand, some customers have higher end performance needs. They may have higher IOPS or throughput need per disk, or have a sub-millisecond latency need, in which case UltraDisk will be the better fit. And underneath each of these SKUs, what we have is different disk sizes. That way you can choose the size you need. These sizes provide you with a combination of capacity, IOPS, and throughput, and you don't have to worry about fluctuations. You can assume you can observe that promised provision performance consistently. And in cases of UltraDisk, you can configure capacity, IOPS, and throughput independent of each other, which gives you a lot more flexibility to get to the performance you need. And on top of this, we have additional performance capabilities. Depending on the performance nature of your workload, you can take advantage of them to optimize your cost and still adhere to performance needs of your customers. For example, we have credit-based bursting. Credit-based bursting is for the scenarios where your workload may spike unexpectedly for short periods of time. So this allows for you to not provision your storage for high-end performance. You can provision for your average performance if your peak performance needs are not for longer periods of time, because credit-based purchasing on your average performance scenario, you accumulate credits. And then when you need to burst unexpectedly, you can consume these credits for 30 minutes at a time. Let's say you have a different need where your performance increased unexpectedly and your current SKU and disk size selection doesn't satisfy your needs. What you can do is you can enable on-demand bursting and start paying for additional transactions to go beyond your performance limits of chosen disk. And this will allow you to meet customer demand temporarily. But if you see your workload staying at that new customer demand and high performing need for longer periods of time, you may want to instead consider increasing the performance tier. So we have performance tier capability, which you can take advantage of by increasing your tier without having to restart your VM or take downtime. You can have higher scale, high performance disk when you need it. So this is more cost effective if your increased demand is going to stay long for longer periods of time. Lastly, UltraDisk is effective in the cases of lower latency requiring workloads, or your workload needs higher performance on a single disk. And similar to server workloads, database workloads, most of our recommendation applies. There's a few key things in case of databases. Depending on your database, how your database uses disk in the backend may differ. Some databases are more in memory, and some databases take advantage of the disk right away. For example, as you're making transactions, if your transaction is directly going to the disk, and your disk latency will directly affect your transaction performance. As opposed to an in-memory database, you will be more affected by your memory situation. For Azure Disk Storage, in case of databases, we recommend you to distribute your disks such that you can have a different OS disk, data disk, and log disk, and you can configure each of them independently and take advantage of different performance specs for each of them for optimal performance at optimal cost. We have guidance on how to do this on various databases published publicly. If you have questions, let us know. And then we have shared disk for clustering applications. In the case of Azure Files also supports clustering. There is differences in case of which versions of clustering work better with files versus disks. It's some older versions of, for example, SQL Server clustering do not support using file shares. They require block storage. But if file storage is good for your needs, that will provide you the good performance. So Azure NetApp Files is going to be a good fit if your database needs require some millisecond latency. Also, it supports Oracle DNFS. Let's take a look a little bit more in terms of when you should use Azure Files versus Azure NetApp Files to get the best out of Azure Storage. So for the most part, your workload will work fine with either. But there are some workloads that are better fit for one versus the other. And Azure NetApp Files will be your choice if you have high-end performance needs and need some millisecond latency or very rich data protection capabilities. So let's take a look at a few examples. Azure Files is a good starting point for you if you have on-premises Windows Server file servers. It's a natural fit for you to onboard and bring those file servers to the cloud. Similarly, if you are already using NetApp on-premises, Azure NetApp Files will be a good segue into cloud for you. And there are some other differences besides the performance we just talked about. For example, if you have a ZRS or GRS type of need in your storage offer, these are different redundancy options. In case you don't know, ZRS is zone redundant storage where your replicas reside in different zones in one region. And GRS is where your replica also resides in another region. So there are some differences in terms of replication methods used and offered today in each service. And ZRS is only supported on Azure Files today. And then there are some protocol differences as well in terms of which versions of protocol either one supports. For example, if you have simultaneous needs for REST API in, alongside needing SMB or NFS, Azure Files may be better fit. Or if you have dual protocol access needs, Azure NetApp Files will be better fit for you. And we have documentation that goes into details of these that we will share with you. So in this demo, we will look into a Cassandra DB setup. Cassandra DB in this case is being used for a retail catalog. It is set up so that it can take advantage of caching. And the way Cassandra DB works, and we will observe this in the demo, is that in this configuration, it is writing to commit log and the data disk as well. And after the writes are done by the application, it is still continuing to write because there is this logic behind in terms of merging the written files after the fact. So you will see the impact of that as we look into the demo. For this configuration, we're going to demonstrate using three nodes of Cassandra DB on three VMs. Each VM has four disks attached. So here we are seeing the performance specs of this. So with the four striped disks, you will be able to go up to 20,000 IOPS and 1,000 throughput. Let's take a look at a little bit how this works. First here, I will show using FIO tool that we can reach the performance limits of disk and VM of our configuration. So I'm running a throughput test here and we're gonna just read one file. In this case, what we are seeing is the observed throughput. It is 926 megabytes per second, close to what we were expecting, about around 1,000. And then I'm running an IOPS test. And in this case, it is reading 8 files. And if you can take a look at the IOPS value we observe, it is averaging around 20,000 IOPS like we intended it for it to be. What we will do next is that we're going to start looking at stats on each Cassandra DB node. So here, the top left corner is where I have the client, where I will execute the test from. And the other three windows are my Cassandra DB nodes. And in this tool, you can see the performance of the log disk. MD0 is my log disk. And the next columns are for my data disk. And the networking column you can see is showing the network throughput going in and out. First, we're going to write. And in this case, as I explained in the behavior, you're going to observe the writes going to the log disk and the data disk. And after the write is done, there will still be activity on both of those disks while the file merges are going on. So the test is going. And you can see we are seeing network activity and we are starting to see activity on both of those disks. It's going to take a bit and finish soon. Yeah, the test is finished. You're still seeing network activity finished, you can see, but we are still seeing writes going through in both the log disk and data disk as expected. Once the that traffic is zeros here, I'm going to run the test for reading it. This test, essentially, we just written it. So we're expecting these reads to come through the cache. So we're not expecting disk activity in this case. Yeah, the test has finished. We didn't see disk activity, but we have seen network throughput. And then we are observing an average 1.7 millisecond latency when reading from the cache. Next, I'm going to read another data set. This data set I have written before this demo. And I have made sure I clear the memory and restart my Cassandra DB nodes. So I expect this one to actually read from the disk. As you can see, it's happening right now. And it's finished. And we are seeing similar latency. So as you can see, with the read-only caching enabled and with this setup, we are able to see similar performance, whether we read from in-memory or disk, and reach about consistent latency around low single-digit milliseconds. So this is the performance we have observed with FIO 20,926. And essentially, we have seen the behavior of Cassandra DB writes as well. And this is kind of configuration we see customers use in production. And in different databases, there will be different considerations as to how they leverage this. And we have some public guidance on those as well. Next, let's talk a little bit more on SAP. And SAP, as you may know, has both apps and databases. So database needs in this case is a bit different because SAP HANA is largely an in-memory database. And SAP has stringent performance requirements as well as certification requirements. So we have both Premium, UltraDisk, and Azure NetApp Files certified for SAP. And what we mostly recommend and see is that for SAP HANA, for scale-up scenarios, UltraDisk may be a good fit. And then for scale-out scenarios, NetApp works well. And also in case of apps, these apps mostly require NFS file share and NetApp is a good fit for those. And if you have OS disk needs, we largely recommend Premium SSDs. Next up on virtual desktop. So in case of virtual desktop, there are two considerations in terms of data storage. One, OS disk of your virtual desktop. The recommended is Premium SSD for consistent and low latency. And in cases of user profile storage, where you're trying to persist your user data, you can use Azure Files or Azure NetApp Files. And by being able to configure your user file storage independent of your VDI setup, you're able to optimize costs and get the best out of both solutions. Also, you can use the setup using Active Directory to control permissions. So virtual desktop offers different workload types as a description. This is kind of like a high level thinking in terms of what may be best fit for you. And we align our storage recommendations to these configurations as well. So they have light, medium, heavy, and power use cases. And these differ in case of scale, number of users, or in terms of high performance needs. And similar to other use cases we have talked about before, for the most part, premium tier of Azure Files will be a cost-effective solution that meets most needs. But there will be customers who has high-end performance needs or low latency, sub-millisecond latency, in which case NetApp Files will be a good fit. And lastly, we have storage for VMware solution. We announced disk pools. We also have an Azure NetApp Files solution for preview. And these solutions, similar to virtual desktop, allow you to scale your storage independent of your workload and optimize costs. And I have talked about what we recommend, and we also have customers' codes in terms of how they took advantage of these different solutions in their environments. We have these case studies published publicly, and you can look into details of each of them. I was personally involved in the Procter & Gamble use case and was happy to see them take advantage of UltraDisk low latency and able to retain their own performance, on-premises performance needs as they move to the cloud. And we have a bunch of resources we're sharing with you. And if you're looking for additional documentation and cannot find it, we're looking forward to your feedback. We hope you found this session useful, and thank you.